Welcome. My name is Nicholas Gaiano, and I work at the National Institute of Health. Welcome to Introduction to the Principles and Practice of Clinical Research in this part of the course. So this part is one of a four-part series related to the NIH peer review process, and this is part four. Part one was the fundamentals of the submission process that were described, fundamentals of NIH in the submission process. Part two related to how study sections work and how the evaluations are drawn up. Part three is about sort of application content and also early career types of awards. A lot goes into putting together an NIH application. It's a lot of work for the applicants and it's a lot of work for the review panels to assess. So you're best off trying to stack the deck in your favor by taking advantage of ways in which you can increase the likelihood that your application will be positively reviewed. So really what I'm going to go over here is a few pieces of information that are put together from having seen many of these applications come through and ways in which they can go wrong. And really the most successful applicants tend to have certain types of patterns of behavior. What I would say it's a critical first step is to really assess your ability to develop a strong application. That may seem obvious, but it's surprising sometimes. You know, you may have great ideas, and I'm sure many, most, all of you do, but the idea needs to fit with what you're qualified to work on, the kind of team that you can assemble, and the kind of resources that you have available to you. So if you are reading the literature and you see some interesting things and you're working in a certain area and you think, oh, wow, I bet I could write a project that's of interest and I'll work on that now. And you write a proposal, but there's no particular history to suggest that you're the right person to be doing that work, that can introduce issues. Now, most people don't do that. What I'm describing was a little bit overstated, but on a subtler level, you really need to think about whether or not you can do something. Is there a major method that's needed that you don't have any experience with, even if it's the whole project is in your area, but a critical component of it you don't have any expertise with? And if that's the case, you need to get that expertise, right? So that's why it's important to really think about what's needed to make an application that would be competitive as far as having all the needed parts in place. There's a piece of that, of course, is have you included the necessary team members, right? And in some cases, it's important to get letters of support indicating that you have a full team assembled, or of course, you could have people as a part of the application. But then if you want to make the case, for example, that you're going to develop a resource that people are going to want to utilize, it's good to have letters of support to provide evidence of that. Now, another critical part of the process is generally it's recommended to contact what's called a program officer at the NIH. The program officers are members of the staff. Their role is to think about the science in the field, to develop initiatives, and also very specifically their role is to work with applicants, to help applicants to sort of shepherd them through the process, to think about maybe some of the nature of their work. Does it fit with given objectives at an institute? They really are there to provide a resource for you with respect to your scientific endeavors and how those might blend with the interests of the institute that they work at. In a typical FOA, which is funding opportunity announcement, the program officer would be listed towards the bottom under agency contacts. That person is the scientific/research contact. That's in section seven. And it is generally a very good idea, especially for specialized types of requests for applications, for example, to reach out to the program officer and share what you're thinking with them regarding the project. Now, you can share a copy of your specific aims with them. They are happy to read those for you and talk with you about whether or not this is the right type of grant to put together for the particular initiative you're looking at, or whether you might be better looking at a different institute, or if it just doesn't seem like it's ready for prime time, those kinds of things. I cannot stress that enough, how valuable talking to a program officer can be when it comes to formulating your project. Okay. So I also cannot stress enough the importance of starting as early as possible. I would say 3 to 4 months before the receipt date or as soon as the FOA or funding opportunity announcement is published. They're not always published 3 to 4 months in advance. Sometimes it can be as few as 2 months, and that's really unfortunate, but when that happens. But I really think you should look at it pretty much as quickly as you can when it's published. That's as soon as that general information becomes available to everyone. Several months of preparation may sound excessive. I mean, for example, an R01 application, or that's the kind of main investigator-initiated research project grant that the NIH supports, it's only 12 pages for the actual research strategy, okay? But, and so you can probably write 12 pages in a weekend, perhaps, right? However, what's in those 12 pages, as well as the rest of the application, of course, the entire configuration of what's there is important, but those 12 pages should be extremely well thought out, extremely well supported, okay? And so that part of it, really crafting the whole application, and in particular, the research strategy, that should take months, frankly. And if you're not dedicating months to it, you are probably selling yourself short regarding the quality of the product that you could submit. It takes a lot of time to conceptualize and formulate strong projects. Now, of course, if you already have a research program working, you're not creating it from scratch, but now you're trying to propose the next steps. And that does require some formulation and thinking about what you're going to do in the future. It takes time to determine what preliminary data would most effectively support the proposed project. And what often happens is investigators start to put proposals together, and what they realize is that as they write it out and they think about the hypotheses to be tested, they realize then that they don't have a certain piece of preliminary data that would really support what they're proposing to do. And often that becomes evident while the application is being constructed. So that's another reason to start months in advance, because if you decide you need to collect additional preliminary data and you're working on the grant the weekend before the deadline, you're probably going to be out of luck at that point. So big reason to start early. You also want sufficient time to get feedback from collaborators and colleagues. If the earlier you can get that kind of feedback regarding how you're formulating the project, the better, because people can help you think it through and maybe refine some of the ideas. What unfortunately happens sometimes is that individuals working on grants, if they're kind of behind schedule, they'll ask their colleagues to look at it, but they'll ask them to look at their application, again, the weekend before it's due. At that point, there's not a whole lot they can tell you that will help you if you still want to submit it on time. They can look for typos, they can explain certain things that are not clear. But in terms of thinking through the science and the project and does the preliminary data really support the application in the way that you think, if when you ask for feedback is too close to the submission date, you're really not going to get particularly helpful feedback, at least not nearly as helpful as it could have been. Also, it should be said, you know, there's real value in seeing what has been successful before. So if you can find examples of NIH applications or awards to learn from, do you have any colleagues or collaborators, you know, folks at your institution, someone down the hall, a faculty mentor who's applied to the NIH and can show you what they put together? Ask to see their applications. Most colleagues will be happy to share those with you, especially if you're trying to submit your own. It benefits the institution to have support and actively funded researchers. Obviously, those applications that were successful in their funding would be of particular interest, because then you can see what actually was awarded and what did it look like in that application stage. You can look at if they'll share that with you, their summary statements as well. You can also look in, there's a number of resources online, but one in particular is called the NIH Reporter. And you can look there and search within your area of interest. You can search in Reporter and see what types of projects has the NIH funded. Now, you won't have access to the whole application in that setting, but you will have access to the abstract and some additional information that will at least help you understand, okay, here's the type of project that is in my field and they were willing to fund this. So I think I maybe am on the right track. Okay. Now, it's going to be important to consider the process from a reviewer's perspective, okay? Reviewers are very busy, overcommitted people. They have many competing priorities, as I'm sure do you as applicants. They're recruited to apply a critical eye towards the evaluation of the applications. They're not sort of brought in to cheerlead or, you know, talk about how everything's great, right? But the idea of this process is to try and determine, really, you know, using in some ways scientific method is meant to be critical and to make sure that that what emerges out the other side of any endeavors will be a solid piece of information. So they're brought in to evaluate these applications with a critical eye. Reviewers will be knowledgeable about the work. They may not necessarily know you. There may be some members of the field who know you in that meeting, but I wouldn't presume that that you would say be successful based on your reputation or any such thing. The quality of the investigator will factor into the review, and as been discussed in other parts of the course, the investigator is a criterion that goes into thinking about an application. But really, the reviewers are going to focus most heavily on things like the research strategy, the approach, the innovation, and the significance of the work. They're going to be knowledgeable about that work, okay? So you want to make sure that you've been very clear about what you're proposing. Now, it's also worth mentioning that not everyone on the panel is an absolute expert in your specific field, okay? So if you write your application as if your closest collaborator were the only person who was going to read it, such that only the two of you even understand some of the specific details, you're going to probably run into trouble. A panel usually is comprised of individuals with a range of expertise that's needed to cover the range of applications that are submitted. Sometimes it's also the case that we, you know, review staff will assign individuals who can understand a given area, but perhaps are one step outside of it so they can provide a broader perspective. If you only have people smack in the middle of a field reviewing applications, there's typically an automatic assumption that it's high significance. So sometimes having somebody look at it from a little bit one step outside can provide added perspective. You should avoid the excessive use of field-specific jargon in these applications because, again, not everyone is going to know the very fine details in your area. You also want to consider how accessible your application is to scientists in related fields. You don't need to make it accessible to somebody way outside your field. I mean, it is a scientific endeavor you're proposing, and there should be a fair bit of specifics in there. So you don't have to try and make it accessible to the entire scientific community. Ideally, the panel will be composed of people that are in your area and are in related areas. They can read your work and understand fundamentals. So you want to make it accessible while also still being reasonably specific. It's also critical to make the significance of the work as clear as possible. This is something that is often not entirely clear to panels. And, you know, they can sort of make their own determinations about what the significance may be, but it's really helpful if you put that front and center. If this work is successful, these are the ways in which I will advance the field. Ideally, reviewers shouldn't have to figure that out on their own. They ideally may be able to, but it's really critical if you emphasize that. Okay. So finally, just another part of thinking about the process from a reviewer's perspective. So happy reviewers are more likely to be positive. You want to prepare a well-organized and clearly written application. More does not mean better. So don't cram your research strategy. I've seen applications where they use the smallest font allowable. They use half-inch margins all the way around. There's no spacing between sections. The sense that you have to get all this content in there or the panel's not going to be able to understand or make a fair judgment, you need to free your mind from thinking that way, okay? If you're submitting, for example, an R01, everyone has the same 12 pages. And people can make their case for their project within that space without cramming every possible square millimeter. And actually, what you find is that you will begin to irritate reviewers if there's too much content. It's also very helpful to use flowcharts, diagrams, very clear figures. You don't want, you know, put a figure in there that's got 15 sub panels that takes up half a page. And then what typically happens is the legends are like extremely small. Just think about this. You know, ask even, you know, colleagues if they're looking at these for you to give you a sense of how clear is this, how visually comfortable are they looking at this application? Because that really can factor in. These reviewers are going to be looking at a number of applications. They're doing this, you know, at night, on the weekends. So just keep it in mind that, as I said, a happy reviewer is more likely to be positive. Finally, avoid making mistakes that may reflect poorly on you or the research team. Sometimes folks don't follow application instructions, the SF-424, and there are instructions in the funding opportunity announcement, and those were described a few parts earlier. And then also don't put information in the wrong sections. Sometimes there's a variety of places you can put content and try and make sure that really sort of goes back to following the instructions. I've seen cases where somebody refers to a figure three and there is no figure three, or the references, they somehow got renumbered in the text, but not in the citations. And so they're all out of whack. That is very frustrating to reviewers, and you absolutely want to avoid that. You want to avoid spelling, grammar, math errors, any typos. Again, this may all be self-evident, but you would be surprised. I think anything you can do to avoid these things would be valuable. This also factors into why you do not want to be doing any of this last minute. So several slides ago, I talked about trying to do it as soon as possible, try and get it started months in advance. Well, all of that factors into this sort of aspect of things. All right. Well, thanks for your attention. And I hope you found this useful.